Pessoal, boa tarde. Meu nome é Edgar. Eu estou aqui nesse painel aqui agora. Estou aqui, à minha direita está o Asanka, que é o VP de Arquitetura e Soluções da WSO2 Global. Tem aqui o Clóvis Bichovski, que é um dos nossos parceiros daqui do Brasil, lá do Paraná. Aqui à minha esquerda eu tenho o Felipe, que é do nosso parceiro aqui de São Paulo, que é a Lighthouse. Okay? Eu tenho ali o Anael, que trabalha nos nossos clientes aqui, que está nessa live. E esse painel aqui é para a gente fazer um bate-papo, a gente vai aqui compartilhar algumas coisas com vocês, vai tentar ser o mais informal possível, tentar ser o mais colaborativo possível. A fim de ser um pouco bacana aqui com o Asanka, a gente vai fazer em inglês, para que ele possa participar. Então eu vou mudar para inglês, mas assim, tem a tradução e fique à vontade de perguntar, se é perguntar em português também, fique à vontade, ok? Vocês estão em casa. Aqui, na verdade, a ideia é tornar o mais produtivo possível para vocês. Então, eu vou perguntar aqui, vou perguntar para todo mundo aqui, each of you guys are enabling a connected business that extends a process across the organization, your partners and your customers. Can you give a brief overview of our initiative and the business objectives that you guys are driving with? So, I'm going to start with Philip, and then we can go from afterwards.
Good afternoon, everybody. So, my company here, we are basically on the financial market. And during this particular scenario, we have a lot of difficulties in integrating all the systems that, especially prepackaged systems that people start to buy, and after some time they start to pile up in the back room, in the server room. So, the financial market is a very particular market in the sense that they are very conservative. It's very hard to push for new technologies. So we just came out from that nice presentation of Spark and all this kind of new stuff that we are all seeing in this event here, all the new stuff technology. In the financial markets, and I'm sure in some of the companies that we have, it is very hard to push for new technologies. On the other hand, the need for integrating all this technology is very, very critical for the business success. So, yes, in my experience, the real challenge to become a connected enterprise, and in particular in the financial sector, is to find a way where you can connect securely, because it's a main topic in all, if you go to any enterprise and any financial institution, like a broker or a bank or any other participant in this market, security is number one concern. Also correctness, we talk about correctness, also availability. So any case, that's the greatest challenge that we have here, and I think it's important how we can use correctly the new technologies that are arising, the new kinds of patterns that are arising. You see APIs, management, and all this kind of stuff is very interesting for us because it enables us to do a very simplify the way people integrate. So SOA is always present. So that's the kind of stuff that we usually do.
Yeah, very great. And Anael, at Soriva, how are you guys working to make Soriva more connect, more agile, more integrated? What's the chance? How are you guys dealing with that on a daily basis?
Okay, firstly, good afternoon, everybody. Let me thank you, the organization, for the opportunity to speak. I hope your afternoon has been productive, and I hope I can also share something new with you. So, firstly, let me speak a bit about retail. Retail is a very dynamic industry that aggressively pushes for innovation and ways to enable new business models and new strategic partnerships. So, in that way, whenever we talk about partnership, that usually involves some integration between systems. Now, there are lots of ways to integrate systems, I'm sure everybody is familiar with us too. But the thing is, there are quite some issues that are quite native to the integration process itself. So, when I speak about retail, some core business is pretty much the same among businesses. So let's say we have common objects like orders, we have products, we have catalogs, but then there are some specific concepts. For instance, in Brazil we have this concept of installments, which in the USA is not quite common. So there are some specific concepts and also specific integration patterns that differ between businesses. So for instance, my business maybe has an endpoint that can receive the flow of information, while another business requires me to send the customer information first and the other later. So this gets quite complex. And so whenever I need to integrate with another business, I need to analyze this whole stuff and build my system specification to this partner system. And when I talk just about one partner, that's not quite that complex, especially if the partner has a good design and API or some good documentation. But it gets quite complex once I talk about, let's say, dozens of partnerships, hundreds, even thousands. So suddenly I have this sea of APIs to integrate with. So it gets complex very quickly. So I need ways to make that easier. So whatever we can do to make that process easier is something that's worth a look. So that's my personal belief. And that's an issue we see, specifically in retail for marketplace integration, for instance. Mm-hmm.
That's great. And let me pass to Sanka. Sanka, as you are leading the solution architecture, which kind of trends you can see worldwide speaking in the company looking for this kind of connected business with the you have to tell about that.
Yeah, so in this context, like my role is a little different from the rest of the other two, because I act as an advocate for the customers, as architect and a technology evangelist. So what I see in the market, like people try to fix the fundamentals, like get their the fundamental architecture correctly done, get their service-oriented architecture done, get the services done, as well as parallelly working on the new stuff, like, okay, expose them as API, get the mobile initiatives running, because they can't wait till they fix the backend or the fundamental stuff. They need to compete with the current trends, so they are working parallelly on both. As well as like the everybody focusing on the ROI, because if you are working on an enterprise architecture group or a middleware group, it's really hard to show a ROI from what we do, because everything we do in the back end. So then that's why everybody is interested about this concept called enterprise store, like an app store and an API store, to advertise what the back end developers doing, so everybody can come navigate and then find these applications and invoke it. Because the traditional way, if you have the URL, you know the application. But today it's not like that. You will get all the listed applications and you can go and invoke it. And some fundamentals like security, because it's key, because with this connectivity you are exposing your business and your data to outside or inside application developers, so you have to be concerned about it. So that's another thing that I see.
That's great. I mean, to Clovis, let me get in writing what the answers that the guys are talking about. There's a lot of big trends like a mobile, cloud, internet of things, and things like that, but working with your customers, how are they dealing with selection of a proper vendor, proper partner to establish this kind of solutions? What's your perception of these kind of things?
Yeah, good afternoon. The big problem that the clients find in seeking for such a solution, they seek for solutions that can be interchangeable between multiple client parts, okay? And seeing of this, we can find on WSO2 products a way that is a consolidated platform, okay? Because it's implemented based on Carbon, right? And after seeking for this solution, the clients can achieve more speed because it's integrated in only one vendor, okay? That's created from scratch, the solution, and stay increasing the value to market of the solution.
Cool. And let me ask you, Anna, how you guys, I know that in Soraiba you are using a lot of products, as you mentioned, to deal with retail business. Which are the factors you guys use to select a proper vendor or partner to establish your technology, partner to solve these kind of issues?
Right, okay, so firstly, I'm a big supporter of open source software, so I see it as a very interesting idea, and it's my belief that it provides for safer, more stable and dynamic software. So I see that as a very good strong point. And nowadays there is a very big push for software as a service, but there are some interesting issues in there. Firstly, the ownership itself, the product itself. For instance, you are very much tied with the vendor roadmap for that product. So what happens if they start to go away that you're not prepared or you're not very much interested in yet? What happens if this product is discontinued, for instance? Mm-hmm. Is it easy to change to a different solution later? So I see ownership of the solution as a very strong point. But of course, that's not the only point we see. The application also needs to be stable and mature. However, that often comes in odds with innovation. So there has to be some kind of compromise. And lastly, we also search for future proofness, which is quite a complex exercise. Because market conditions can change and what is true today is not necessarily true tomorrow. So we try to analyze a few ways that can make that a lesser impact on the business. So we usually take a look at the architecture, we take a look at the community, how active the community is, we take a look at of the backer, who is backing this product, who is developing, who is supporting. We take a look at especially cases that already use it. So we look into these factors to start providing a good solution, a good option for the business. Mm-hmm.
That's great. And I'd like to add to Philip that I know he works in the financial, mostly in the financial industry. And I know you have some customers using WSO2 platform actually. So which are the major factors they decide to go with this kind of a platform in the kind of a business where big vendors are the predominant dominance in this kind of area?
Yeah, sure. But you know, sometimes since my company itself just provides the solution, a complete solution, in this kind of scenario, it really doesn't care for the customer what's behind the solution. So in this kind of scenarios, sure, there are some scenarios where the CIO just want to, you know, get a big name to put behind him. So if he goes to the board and say, "Oh, you are buying what kind of I bought a three big letter company,
blue one,
three big blue letters." So nobody can go wrong with that one. Okay, yeah, sure. But you see, so the people come up and spend a lot of money, or even more money, trying to put that big fat solution to work, and even more money, training everybody in their teams to put that big fat solution to work, and in the end, never works, really works, because people sell something that they cannot deliver, because it depends much more on their internal effort to make that things real than in their actual products, because any solution is not only about the products. So when I go, especially about people that are going to use the products and also all the processes that if you don't have the processes that are being automated or being transformed by your solution, you don't get really the real value out of that solution in the end. So it's not about buying stuff. It's all about buying or constructing really a vision for that solution, what kind of problems that solution is going to address. And in that scenario, I think that the product on the WSO2 in particular fits really well, because it allows me to, as a solution provider for my customers, it allows me to simply pick exactly what I need to address a given solution and start from there. And if I need to scale up, okay, I can scale up. If I need more pieces of that puzzle, because a solution is never going to stop in that small POC product that you started with. So then again, I can pick my products and scale, and that I think I found that the business model, as long as the business, the actual products from the LSO tool to be very effective in into addressing this. And this is why I've chosen, in particular, the LSO tool. It's not to be detrimental of other solutions that are around there. Of course, there are other options. But I think that in the whole vision that LSO tool brings is very interesting for me as a solution provider.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
That's my feeling.
That's let me try again. That's for Santa. So getting right what Phil was saying. So how is the WSO2 approach in terms of technology? How we are differentiators to make our customers successful in trying to be connected, you know, business and customers.
Yes, yeah, so like so if I put it from the customer's point of view, I think there are four things. First thing is lead. Second thing is high performance. Third thing is the functionality richness. And then fourth thing is the future. So that's where like you can get more advantage from our platform. The first thing about lean, it doesn't mean lightweight. Lean means like every download is around 120 MB that you can just download it. And then if you look at the memory footprint, it's around 300 MB. And the production server need 2-core 4-gig type of configuration. So that's where the lean nature comes. So it saves a lot of cost because open source bring you some lot of cost saving, as well as when you look at where you run it, a simple VM will be sufficient to run a production system. And the fast or the performance, because middleware add additional layer in between your backend and your consumer channel. So performance is key. That's where like we operate around 2 to 3 millisecond range, the added latency, as well as we can handle 8,000 transactions per second on a mediation engine, and then if you get CEP, it's around 400K transactions per second. And then the functionality richness, if you came to my session that I did in the morning, you saw like the entire platform from data to stream, and then I did another additional slide with this concept called systems that it provide all the layers and how you can position this functionality. So you saw the functionality richness that we provide with these products. And the last thing is the future proofness, because you have to get something that can address the future needs, because you can't do changes very often, so you have to do that decision wisely. That's why we are ahead with most of the vendors. As an example, we released cloud 4 years back. So in those days, it was really hard for me to pitch cloud for a person because they didn't listen. But today, cloud has become a reality. So we have a stable cloud platform because we started it early. So that, like that, we have a lot of technology initiatives that enable you to face the future challenges.
That's great. Let me ask you, Clovis, beyond the technology challenge, so which kind of a cultural challenge you can see when we're trying to adopt like this kind of a new technologies, new connecting business integrations, APIs, SOA? So which are not only the technical aspects, but which are cultural things you can face in the customers and the real implementation actually?
The big thing on implementing SOA solutions is when you try to develop them, right? And when you try to develop, you maybe sometimes find bad ways to follow paths and develop that solution as a ugly. It's so ugly for development speed, and sometimes many developers go away from SOA solutions and try some housekeeping solutions and avoid to try SOA. In this scenario, we encounter some companies that need to develop these SOA solutions, but don't have the technical scenario to implement the solution. In which WSO2, this solution is already ready for production. You can, with simple steps, get the pieces you can implement in our system, design the system, and put in production in a fast time. That in other solutions, maybe you can buy a product, buy a training, buy many, many things, and wait for the seed solution to become real. Okay? Mm-hmm. And another thing I think about WSO2 as a solution for this type of problem, it's the reason for open source. Mm-hmm. It's like a future proof. Mm-hmm. Okay, when you can spend your time learning this solution and don't make me like a problem, because the technology stay growing up every year. We can see new products, new solutions,
new versions.
More support, more clients, more employees working on WSR2. So we see that this is a future-proof company,
okay? Cool.
Where we can, as Felipe says, we can follow and provide solutions that we can trust on your vendor, okay? Mm-hmm. Because in this scenario, the confidence we have is very important.
Just again, the cultural aspect with Anna. So, how you guys are doing? I know you guys, you used to develop a lot of things in house, you know, at Soraiva. And all these cultural aspects, they may impact or not impact, or how you guys are changing or dealing with that in this Soraiva actually.
Right. Fortunately, today's enterprise is much more receptive about open source solutions than some years before. But the major concern, and that's pretty much a hot topic of its own, I mean, the open source adoption in the enterprise. But a major concern is accountability. So business wants someone to run to provide a safe harbor. And some of the time they ask, okay, I'm going to adopt this open source solution, but who's going to take care of it if it doesn't work? And there has to be a change in the thought process, because it's pretty much the other way around. You may not have one big company to run to, but you actually have the whole world to search for vendors, you have the whole world to search for expertise. Mm-hmm. So there is this paradigm change that you have to do, but of course, that's easier said than done. I mean, the business has to be prepared to search for this expertise. It has to be prepared to use this expertise. So that's one major point. So having a big company backing you is certainly a strong point. In this case, now we have WSO2 in Brazil, so that's a big help.
Yeah.
But we shouldn't feel constrained by local partners. The company has to be able to search for help, whatever it may be. Another thing is concerning, it's pretty much a change in the perspective, because they kind of use it to work with local partners for big vendors. You know, usually they have a network of feature partners, and it's not necessarily the case now with open source solution, because we can work with companies in this case that you might not have heard about it. So that presents an issue itself when you search for references, mm-hmm. because you may not have heard about the companies using it, even though the product might be using it. Mm-hmm. So there has to be some kind of active community that we can exchange some use cases, some experience, some questions. And I think that's a very open approach to developing new ideas, new solutions, and it's a very interesting change. But again, you have to think along these ways to make it work.
Mm-hmm. No, that's great. Well, I want to mention a little bit about how the businesses are getting connected. So I have friends here in São Paulo. They are in the Teams business, and they are doing a very interesting thing now. they're gonna start to use the fingerprints or whatever, like cards. They're gonna use the face recognition to let the students go to the gym. And you know, in the Bramley, it's something very like unusual, but they want you. I asked that one of my friends, but why are you gonna do that? And he asked me, and now they're gonna do not only the security and to check who's paying or paying the gym, but they want to recognize even the person moved. So maybe if that person is not maybe under good mood or is happy or sad to be, you want to change the exercising series according to your mood. So and try to get like you know, maybe give you drinks or maybe supplements. They're gonna make you feel better. So it's a constantly in your life. So it's gonna change the entire like students or the people that go, you know, to the gym like here in Brazil. And I can see like the clothes, like you guys are familiar with Under Armour, a kind of a brand, like a very popular in the US. They come to Brazil now. They have a very big store in the shopping mall in B actually. And now they acquire an intellectual things company. They have a kind of a brace that is connected to your kind of a shirt. And you can measure when you are exercising properly, when you, how can I say, spending energy or working out properly, you know, to help you out better and improve yourself. So as we are preaching a lot, you can, when you look at around WSU, you're talking a lot about connected business. So it's everywhere. So it's I can see people here from publishing business, from telco business, from, you know, retail, from security. So everything's getting connected. So I want to take one of those points and ask to Asanka about which kind of a best practice can you mention that companies are using to transform their business into a connected business. So what you can tell about that?
Yeah, actually the talk that I did in the morning covered detailed stuff, but to summarize it, what I would like to say, do a proper system analysis or requirement study of your system and then identify what you can reuse, rather than rebuild it from scratch, and then identify the gap in between what need to be done to be a connected business. So that's the first thing. The second thing is about the iterative or incremental approach. So you have to define the architecture as an enterprise architecture across all your business units and the entire system, but start it from a couple of business units or a couple of projects and then do it as an incremental approach. So that's the technical side of the problem. But the main thing that I even explained during my session is about the people and the political problem, because people don't like change, because whenever there's a change, there's a resistance coming. So you have to apply the change slowly. The best way to do that is engage these people, empower them, and then make sure they are part of the new architecture and they are the implementers of this architecture, and then get their help. So that's the key thing. And so if you don't get their help, then whatever the technical the solution that we are doing will not get implemented. As well as you had to be an advocate, you had to be an evangelist internally in the organization, and then sell this thing internally to other business units as well as other business stakeholders, because otherwise the projects will not come, especially if you are building a platform. So those are the best practices that I can tell in a very high level.
That's great, and I want to ask to Clovis about, okay, we talk about best practices and success case, but I want to hear a little bit about the mistakes. So what kind of mistakes we can avoid when we're trying, starting to connect business to make the company more connected? What you guys can tell about that? Let's start with Clovis.
Wow. Many mistakes.
Too many.
Try get some of those, try to share with the guys.
Okay.
Maybe the people, they're going to be starting this kind of things now, but I want to hit that from the ground. No, that's the deal.
I think that the first mistake we can explain is that SOA is don't product or technology. SOA is a paradigm.
It's a concept.
It's a concept. Without this in mind, many problems will occur, okay?
This is summary, everything.
It's a summary. Because many people think that I will buy that product, or I will train on that project, and solve all my problems. No, isn't it. Because you can, you first, as Asanka said, involve your all your staff on planning before see what is the solution you need to do before you starting using. Someone can be think that the solution is use only web services. They don't think how to map that solution and to see the all scenario that technology is will be useful, okay? And then I think that is the first one. Maybe now Philip can.
So can I add one?
Yeah, okay. Of course.
So the what I want to add to that, like, don't treat them as products, treat them as frameworks. So that way you can configure it and build your own middleware rather than just take a product and then change your architecture fitting to the product. What you should do, change the product fitting to your architecture. So that's one advantage as a content that we are providing. That's why I always pitch these things as capabilities rather than products. Those are middleware capabilities that you can configure and use it in your own.
Yeah, I'd like to hear a little briefly from Philip. So it'll be like the most common mistakes, like maybe you can
well, see. The most common mistake is not to give a proper name for a project. If the project starts with a bad name, the bad name sticks and the project is doomed,
you know?
So be wise and give it. It's not, when we talk about promoting the project and communicating this project, giving names and very sticky names, even if it's a funny name. I think the Americans have this tradition of giving project code red, project whatever, like the new Navigator web browser from Microsoft, this project Spartan. So it's something that sticks. So give names for your projects and give names for this kind of thing. It's a kind of simple thing that people forget. So especially in Portuguese, we end up project for transformation and
modernization.
So this project whatever. So nobody actually becomes lost in all that soap of projects and that ocean of. So you have to have very distinctive names for everything you're going to do. So that's not technical at all, but there's something that I think is very effective. Every time I haven't done stick to my home rule, it was a mistake. So people end up forgetting or not actually giving the proper credit for the product.
Yeah,
because if it's a successful product, people are going to remember, oh, that's the project X1. Okay,
everybody knows this problem. I want to hear a little bit about what your energy patterns or what kind of advice you can give to avoid big mistakes in this.
Sure, I'm also a believer in keep it simple philosophy. I think a lot of issues are to over engineering, right? So if you can keep it simple, that may be an ideal practice.
Okay, that's really great. And one of the things that I like to add to this kind of scenario, so we have, first, as a lot of people many times they are looking for products, right? And all the time they are looking for, for instance, I'm getting my friend, what's your name? It's Tiare. If let's think that I now, an example, right? It's not reality. Imagine I can give you 100,000 reais, right? And I can tell which kind of a car would you buy with 100,000 reais? Useful. But what's, okay, but, no, which car? So just simple question, which car? Oh. I'm giving 100,000 reais for you now, so go and buy a car. Which car would buy? Okay, you don't like cars. Tell me. You don't like cars, okay?
Let me say just one. New Golf.
A new Golf. That's great. Okay, new Golf. So you, maybe a lot of the things you try to think and in order to identify why you like a new Golf, right? Maybe I can guess that you like a fast cars, not so big cars. So you don't like big sedans, like you don't want to be like a grandpa driving a big boat like on the street. It maybe but can I imagine like if I ask you the same question, I have many customers. They would answer they're gonna give the following answer. Oh, do I have a 100,000 to buy a car? So let me try buying like a four tires. I'm gonna buy the mirrors. I'm gonna buy all the parts. I'm gonna bring all the parts to my garage. I'm gonna build my car by myself, and then it'll be the perfect car. Do you think that it works?
No, it's not working. If you like that, if you think like this, we can think about the Apple creating the car, like the CEO of Mercedes told. Mercedes make a mistake when they try to create a cell phone. Apple are doing the same mistake trying to create a car. It's something that they don't have the experience to purchase. Mm-hmm. So I believe that try to create by yourself, you don't have the expertise that some people have to understand some mistake and some behavior behind the solution.
Mm-hmm.
Because of that, I think some expertise people, some expertise solution can help a little bit more than you create your by yourself.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's I do agree with you. Like that, you know, because a lot of people they are reinventing the wheels many times, you know, and you don't need to do that. I hear that very often from many customers. You know, it's not because I work for a vendor. I used to work in other vendors in the past, but it's really complicated when we try to do the things by ourselves. Especially if there is something that something has, like, how many years are we developing the W2 ESP actually?
So we started in 2005.
So maybe over 10 years. So if we get the amount of work done and in terms of money, right? So I can believe we spent a kind of $1 million project already, you know, in place. So you. When you try to do a greater your platform yourself, many times you're gonna compete against this kind of investment. So you're gonna okay, how much do you have in budget to create a integration platform? I'm gonna say, oh, I have a 300,000 BI, let's say. How are we gonna compete to a project that we spend around like $2 million, $3 million, $100 million sometimes? So that's why it's important to be thinking in this perspective. So that's why. I'd like to ask, which is our value proposition?
Yeah, let me add one more thing to that, because like if you look at it, like you have to separate what's the middleware component, what's the applications of that. And if you correctly use your middleware, more than 80% you can get it from the middleware layer, and then you can purely focus on the business problem, and then build an application on top of that. So that's the value that the middleware is bringing.
No, it was just in the... If you get this everything to summarize and everything like that, so I wanna. This would be a very silly question. So, what's our value proposition? Because what's the big value behind to use the W2 stand other vendor, let's say?
So the simple answer is this open platform for a connected business. So because it's open, and the way we work even open, and even you can contribute to the feature list, you can comment about
the what application. Do you mean with open?
So that's basically the all the mailing lists are open that you can subscribe for our architecture list, and then you can reply to that, as well as even you can contribute. So that's the openness house. And internally we are open as well as a company, because everything happens in open mailing lists. So everybody know what's really happening inside the company. So that's the culture that we have. And then the open source license, because you get different type of open source license that got tricky stuff that you will not read at the first time. So because of that, we license everything under Apache 2.0. So it's very business friendly. Even you can OEM it and then create your own product and release it without contributing it back to the source code. So that's the openness coming. Then the open platform for the connected business, why I use the platform word, that's the feature set, because you can just start the project with some set of requirements, but down the line you will get more requirements. Then you should have the capability to get the functionality from a platform. And you can go to number of vendors, but the problem will be the interoperability. Then you will spend a lot of time, these things are not interoperable, and even support, you have to go to different vendors. So that's one advantage that comes with that. And then the last thing is the connectivity, like whatever the fundamentals that you require to be a connected business, you provide from the platform itself. So you just need to get your business requirement done, and then you don't need like a development team that got Java, J2EE, .NET experience. What you need is a set of people who can understand the business requirement and who got some sense about integration, and then concepts like REST, SOAP, that type of background. So easy to find people to develop. And one thing is the configuration driven, that you don't need to code, that it's completely configuration driven. So you can be productive and then give more value to your stakeholders. So that's kind of in summary that value we add as a platform company.
That's great. And just to Anael, just we are about to finish the panel, but one thing that interesting is in terms of not only the driver, but how can you see the retail industry in the next 10 years? What do you think you guys would be able to do, and what do you think is, you know, it can be your guess, can be your, you know, your dreams, your, you know.
Sure. So right now there is a clear movement towards what we call omnichannel, right? And that's pretty much the concept of buying anything you want at any time you want and have it delivered anywhere you want. I think this concept will be taken quite to the extreme. And with machine learning and predictive, people are already exploring ideas such as trying to predict what you are going to buy, so when you think of it, it's already on your doorstep. So that's a fantastic idea, and I think we will still see that being a handle in our lifetime.
Getting that example, it's a very Minority Report movie, right?
You know, that movie sounds very prophetic.
Yeah.
Lots of ideas from that movie are already true.
Of course, so, yeah. But so getting this as is a very interesting. Do you think that could be possible if you don't work and to get a proper connecting stuff now? Do you think you can be able to accomplish that in the future?
Oh, I don't. I think we need to reach out with a partnership, with a strategic cooperation. That's pretty much required because. If you try to develop everything by yourself, you're not going to reach out, you're not going to be able to get forward in time, you're not going to pass the competition stage. So you need to have a solid base, and for that, we need to do this partnership.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Okay, guys, so now we'd like to invite you guys to come to that conversation. So we'd like to hear from you guys. That can be in Portuguese, that can be in English, so. Wherever, can be in German, you speak German, can be in French, you speak French, so, you know, so whatever, you know, so what questions, well, what kind of, maybe as Thierry, he said a lot of very interesting stuff, so would you like to add something else? I can give you the microphone, just to.
Sometimes I have to consider it when I create some application, the kind of accomplish I will have with some third-party service. Mm-hmm. So, because I had a few problems with some companies that give some services and then stop to work. I don't know, it's not the case, but I need to think about the third-party service. Which type of accomplishment I have inside my application? Because if I may think, let me think. For example, if I get some a few services and those services start to be in production environment. So, my application is stopped, I need to take off that product from the market. This can be a kind of problem. Mm-hmm. And my board inside the company make me think 10 times more about this kind of problem, the dependence between providers. Mm-hmm. How the WSO2 think about this? How can you guarantee or give some information that can help my board accept that idea to have this service behind my application for my clients?
Yes. So can start to answer it.
So basically, you provide SLA for your partners who serve consuming your services. So that's where the non-functional features that come into the picture, especially the high availability. So you can build a high available system. but it will not resolve the entire problem because you should have the scalability as well. Because since you are giving access to a third party, you will never know that there can be a massive throughput come and hit your system. So that way, it has to scale up to some extent. But you can control it. That's where the concepts like throttling come into the picture. You can tell this partner can access or invoke this number of services in a given time. And the API management provides all these fundamentals because you provide a subscription for your partner by providing an SLA, as well as you give, okay, this number of API invocation can be done within a second. So that way you can make sure that one partner will not affect other partners. Your same service can be shared with number of partners as well. So that way you can build this high availability as well as scalability by using SQL and then guarantee your SLA. And for you, because you can tell the customer you will guarantee the SLA, but you should know what's really happening. That's where the analytics, that you will analyze it in near real time as well as real time way. That way, before something happens, you know, and then you can get the necessary actions into that. And addition to that, concepts like dynamic scale, because static scaling can scale up to some level, but you can incorporate the concepts like dynamic scaling that part is very detailed. So we have the enterprise ready deployment practices done. And that's where like Boeing, eBay, they are running 24/7 without issue using our products by enabling this.
Yeah, I would like to add something about that, because of course you have back, but perhaps I would ask back to your bosses about that or the board. So because you talk about the lack of availability of a technical availability failure. So the business may be out of business, but a communication link also can have a failure. So what you do in the infrastructure? You have two links. You have three links. So there's another thing besides that, that's to embrace the concept of failure early in your design. So you can probably show to your board that, okay, it's okay to fail. Someone will fail. You must assume that at some point, every single external dependency you have at some point will fail. And if you don't architect to put that requirement that then this is a business requirement that you must go back to your business owner, your product owner, depending on the kind of manager you have, that figure of product owner. So, I'll give you an example. Once I was in a meeting discussion, early stage of the project, and the first question, the guy, well, it was a simple site, website that was supposed to give some quotes. Historical quotes. Nothing very fancy. Which is actually the common case in the financial scenario. Not 99% of the systems that we have in the financial system are not fancy at all. Just basic reporting. So, anyway, the guy needed this information. And I asked, okay, but what about availability? Hold on, I want 100% availability. I said, man, come on.
Just the depth is 100%.
What? Yeah, no, it must be available all times during business hours. Okay, so it's not 100%, but it costs, how much it costs for you if you, for instance, must skip if the system's out of, goes down for 1 hour. No big deal, I can do the same business I can do using a backup system. So, you see, the guy was putting a requirement on the system that would be hugely expensive, because if the guy would go forward with that requirement, the system must be 100%, must have 100% availability. We'd need a huge amount of hardware and links, or redundant links, or whatever. But the business does not require. So, my advice when someone questions about availability or external partners, first, you have to have redundancy. If it's a critical system, you have to. Sometimes people have redundancy on, for instance, if you have a messenger system, you call the office boy, the water boy, as you call it in Brazil, everybody knows the water boy is the office boy that goes on motorbike. That's the concept. So you don't have just one company that.
That's the kind of service.
Yeah, that kind of service. You have multiple numbers. If someone does not have a you ask a pizza. If the guy doesn't have a pizza in 15 minutes, you call another one. So it's the same thing with the software as a service. The business can understand this kind of thing. So that's my
There's a concept called passion is not the IC. If you read white paper, so that's the concept that from the design you start thinking about passion and then design as a step.
Yeah, and beside that, one thing I can just add, just briefly, it's WC2 is a company, it's an organization, right? So we are here exactly to provide this kind of security for you guys, providing support, providing services, providing consulting, providing training and everything, not only us, but also all partners together. So that can make your board and your bosses rely on these kind of relationships. It's not a kind of relationship that, like a romantic open source that you can get the things for free. Because open source is very popular in Brazil as a free software. And not like open as a freedom, as a open in terms of a standards and things like that. People get confused and open with free. Right. So many times when people come into meeting, they think that like, wow, and we must have like $2 million to pay a certain salary every year. You know, so it's costing not too much. So we have to make money some way. You need to make money some way. Everybody must make money some way. So we have business. So the business is actually to support you guys in this kind of thing. Okay. Any other question? Any other comment? So can I? Thank you.
And I was talking a little bit about some advices, right? And the challenge that we have nowadays in the retail business is to have the omnichannel ready to all the customers. And since we have this point of view, we have this statement, sometimes we consider in our companies that we are not ready to have a good SOA. And Clovis talked a little bit about it also. We have a lot of mistakes between connections, integrations, we don't have canonical visions. And I would like to ask a little bit about it to you guys, if it's necessary to have a mature SOA before try to expose an API and be mobile ready. Is it fair or we can do it in parallel?
I think I answered that when I asked the first question so it's a parallel thing that you should do because you can't wait. So you have to find the shortest path. So that's where we help. So I will give an example. So we work with a US-based electronic trading company. So they were moving from Seoul to REST. They spent around 3 to 4 days to 3 to 4 weeks to expose one service as an API by rewriting a wrapper. So we went there on site and then we spent 1 week and then exposed 140 APIs out of the services. That because of the mediation power that we have, that can connect to different systems as well as you can do the transformation and expose it as a new version of the service that I call it as an API ready service. So you can use some tools and then kind of make it a shortcut. It might be not the perfect thing to do, but it will work, and then gradually you can change other stuff. So eBay is a good example. Their entire service stack was SOAP. So they used the mediation to expose it as a RESTful service, and they started a project called Raptor, I think, to convert all the backend SOAP services into REST. It's a 3-year project that they will do incrementally and then implement this. And like that, you can have an approach that probably work on those things because fine. Like once you get the APIs done from RESTful, it might be not REST at that time. So you have to quickly get these things done and roll out information.
Yeah. There's one thing I would add is, we need quick wins, right? So it must be agile. So sometimes we have there is someone from Florianopolis here. But Florianopolis have a kind of a bridge, right? And they are building another bridge, side by side. So they have like the two bridges, like they have the old one that still works, but it's not so safe to pass with your car. But you can use to walk. That's fine, right? So they build a new bridge that you can use your car. So now they have the both bridge, and then you can decide. So according to your you know, action, you can decide which bridge you can use. So solution like that, it's like this from, there's nothing related to technology, but it's a nice example to show how we can use the thing. So maybe you can have a, like, maybe my Wisdo is not the best one, or my integration is made with a Firefresh frame or FTP or whatever. It's not maybe the best one, but it's useful for something. And then you can, in parallel, use it like a proper way, in a very agile way, like incremental way, as Sek was mentioned, to accomplish, you know, state of the art project. So that was a recommend as a consultant. So that's what I was always looking for when I was still in consulting side, right? Okay, does that answer your question? Okay. Any other question, other comment? Any other complaint?
Anything? One thing to your thing, question. So basically the business users, they don't care whether it's SOAP or REST. So what they need is to bring more business value. So that's why we need to like find the shoulders.
Any other question? No? How much time do we have here?
It's already over.
It's over? Oh!
But you know, the room will be empty after you guys leave. So you can take as long as you want.
Okay, so thank you. So, guys, any question em português, alguma pergunta, vocês não fiquem envergonhados, por favor, qualquer coisa, algum comentário. Então, vou finalizar aqui o painel. Queria muito, I'd like to thank you so much, Santa, first for your first time in Brazil, so we do our best to, you know, to host you as best as we can, right? The clubs that came from Paraná, and Anael and Felipe here from São Paulo, but they daily activities to be here with us to share this kind of talks with you guys. And I'd like to also thank you guys so much. This is very important for us, for WC2 as a company. It, KubeCon 2015 represents our landing in Brazil, so now it's more than official. If you guys go, we're very happy, because if you go to wc2.com.br, it's still a website in Portuguese already. So we, now this is a very important, very personally very happy with that, so we're gonna do our best to not only have you guys as a customer, but as a success, the partners in successful case. That's our team, okay? Any last things for you guys, you people?
I'd just like to thank you for the opportunity. I hope I was able to share something useful. And that's till next time, I guess.
Yeah, of course. Really?
I'm not.
You don't have to. Okay. Okay.
Let's go. Just
say thank you for the presence.
Oh, by the way, be in the party tonight. It's 7:30. It's be in the club here, in the club here. It's be in that place. So it's a very fancy, by the way, so if the people is not for São Paulo, it's a very nice place to go. You know, so drinks and some fun and some food to be available for you guys. So that's very nice to have you there. Your last stuff?
So yeah, as you said, this is the first time in Brazil, a really good experience for me. And
we have to go to the barbecue place, then it'll be a nice experience.
So the one thing I figured it out, like from the questions and the discussions I had, that's a really good technical education system here. That's what I figured. People are very geeky and very useful, very really good questions, as well as everybody's family with the concept. So that's a really good thing that I found. So
that's great. Okay. So thank you guys. See you next year.